Joining me today is Dr. Marty Makary. He is professor at Johns Hopkins School of Medicine and School of Public Health, and the author of The Price We Pay, What Broke American Healthcare and How to Fix It. The paperback for that book is coming out tomorrow, June 8th. Dr. Makary, thanks so much for taking the time to join me today.
Great to be with you, Samantha.
Now, I just want to dive right in and talk about vaccines and natural immunity. As you know, as a doctor, as soon as the vaccines became readily available, there has been this unwavering push to get people vaccinated. But something that's not talked about nearly as much as vaccines is this conversation about natural immunity. Now, this piece that recently came out talks about, quote, while natural infection may not provide permanent infection blocking immunity, it offers anti-disease immunity against severe disease and death that is likely permanent. Among the millions that have recovered from COVID-19, exceedingly few have become sick again. I know you have a piece coming out for the Wall Street Journal. Can you talk about natural immunity and how that lines up with people who are vaccinated?
Well, natural immunity is real and it works. And one of the greatest failures of our public health officials has been ignoring natural immunity. And they're disenfranchising about half the country, because about half the country has natural immunity from prior infection. About 10% of the country has had a documented COVID positive test. And for every one person who has tested positive, another 3, 4, or 5 people have not tested. That is, they were sick or exposed and never had access to a test, got to a test. They tested during the asymptomatic phase when the tests are not as good. So many more people have had COVID than the tests show on the trackers. It's about half the country right now. As a matter of fact, that was validated by a California study that found that back in March, 38% of Californians had circulating antibodies, that is natural immunity. That was at a time when vaccine rollout was at a very low level. So natural immunity is powerful, and more data is coming out now showing just how long lasting it is. Probably lifelong. It's probably lifelong immunity. We'll find out. But right now, when people say, hey, there's no data on natural immunity, I would say there's more data on natural immunity than there is on vaccinated immunity, and it works.
Just along the same lines of people who have gotten the vaccine versus people who've actually gotten the virus, you know, there's been a ton of incentives, whether it's, you know, a free donut, or from this article specifically, it talks about the European Union, you know, allowing travel for people who are vaccinated, but not people who had COVID-19. So, you know, whether it's not wanting to get the vaccine for, you know, whatever reason people may have, or, you know, the fact that they already have this natural immunity, what are those people supposed to do? I mean, it seems like they can't really get back to their lives fully until they're vaccinated.
Gosh, it's so frustrating, Samantha. The entire world of public health, old establishment, old guard medical groupthink has created two categories of people, the vaccinated and the unvaccinated, completely ignoring the fact that about half of the unvaccinated have natural immunity. And they don't know what to do with these folks. And they say, well, just get the vaccine. Maybe we don't know if you need it, but, you know, just get it. And the reality is that those folks should have the same privileges as somebody who is immune. So I use the term immune and non-immune. Now, if you ignore natural immunity, it changes everything in terms of your outlook on COVID. If you ignore natural immunity, the pandemic is still raging and it could keep going forever, because in order to get to 85% population immunity, you've got to have mandates and get a whole lot of kids vaccinated and demonize the hesitant. That's the outlook for somebody who ignores natural immunity. If you say, hey, wait a minute, 63.5% of adults are vaccinated and half of the unvaccinated have natural immunity, that means we're at 80 to 85% of adults in America today who are immune. That's why cases are plummeting. That's why we're below 10,000 cases. That's why we're doing so well. And remember, most of the cases we're diagnosing are asymptomatic, and most of the remainder are mild.
It's just so fascinating to me to see, you know, people, I mean, this is sort of a little bit different, obviously, but even people walking outside completely alone, you know, not near anyone, wearing a mask still. And it's sort of like when you go into, you know, a mom and pop shop, maybe they'll make you wear a mask, maybe they'll not. But then you go to, you know, more of a bigger name store, and, you know, the same thing, like the I guess you could say the criteria are different. Do you think there will ever be a consensus on terms of, you know, being able to, you know, drop the mask completely? Or do you think we'll keep seeing these mask mandates or recommendations for certain stores in certain places throughout the country?
I don't know, Samantha, but we have a completely distorted perception of risk in the United States right now. The number of daily COVID cases that we have is 1/50th the number of daily influenza cases that we have in the middle of a mild flu season. 1/50th. And a similar case fatality rate now that COVID is in younger people. So the idea that somehow, you know, we're still in a state of emergency, as California just announced they're going to continue until mid-June, it's absurd. And it's sad because when I come through Reagan Airport and I see most of the businesses and shops in there closed in the middle of the afternoon during the week, it's a sad day for the American worker. And it's just, it's overkill. I was out for ice cream with a couple friends this weekend, and I asked for a sample of vanilla ice cream. And the person said, "We're not doing samples because of COVID." I mean, at some point we've got to move on. If we meet the criteria now to be in a state of emergency, we're gonna be in a perpetual state of emergency forever because the case numbers now are way below seasonal flu.
What do you think will help people get past? I mean, if it's, you know, it was always follow the science, follow the data. If we have the data, then why aren't people, you know, essentially following it? What do you think is preventing them from doing that?
Look, I think we need medical leadership, and we have had failed medical leadership. Our medical leadership has been fear-mongering, talking about concerns of surges incessantly, even though we have broad population immunity. They warn of variants, even though we've had hundreds of variants. And every variant that has ever popped up in the history of COVID has not been able to evade the life-saving protective effect of the vaccinated immunity or natural immunity. So we've got to start talking about the good news. I'm doing what I can. You know, I'm out there trying to write pieces. I wrote a series in the New York Post trying to explain the case. I try to write for a bunch of different outlets. I think we need more and more people citing the data, because remember, a lot of these decisions are by community members on a school board. They're by members of any organization that are trying to decide whether or not to do things. I go to a lot of conferences. They're trying to figure out if they should plan events right now. We need everybody to start using the data and not stop relying on our public health officials and start making our own decisions based on the numbers.
I just want to now talk about your book a little bit, because before we started the interview, you were telling me that this new paperback edition that's being released on Tuesday has a look back at the last year of our country dealing with COVID-19. And I want to walk through some of the things that you touch upon in this new, this new edition that's in your book. You know, I don't want to go back to March of 2020, but can you just sort of give us your insight into how the pandemic could have been dealt with differently, and anything you could predict for the future in terms of how the country deals with, you know, hopefully, God forbid, another pandemic?
Sure. Yeah. And I don't blame you, Samantha, for not wanting to go back mentally to the spring of last year. The missteps of the pandemic are obvious to everybody. We don't need to relive that. And I don't revisit that in my book, The Price We Pay. But what I do say are some things I don't think people are aware of. And that is, the NIH was unable to pivot a penny of its $40 billion in the beginning of the pandemic to study the most basic questions. How does the infection spread? How many people are asymptomatic? Do masks work? When are you most contagious? Where does it spread? None of those questions got answered by all of this government power that we had in the NIH, CDC, FDA. And so we had a vacuum of information, and guess what? Political opinions filled that vacuum. We shouldn't make that mistake again. And we've got to mobilize our bureaucratic, slow, turtle health agencies in the government, the NIH, the FDA, the CDC, to start moving faster. I'm not just talking about in response to a health emergency, to develop therapies for cancer, to address chronic disease, to create mRNA vaccines for other infections? Why can't we use this technology now to immediately create a vaccine for HIV and other important global infections? Why is malaria is still ignored when 400,000 deaths occurred the year prior to COVID from malaria? I don't think people recognize that we still have a significant burden of acute and chronic diseases in the United States and globally that we can fix. But if we rely on these broken, slow agencies to keep doing business the way they've been doing them, I think we're not going to see significant achievements. We can start making major advances in cancer care. And we got to start addressing the underlying problems that bring people to care, something our national health agencies like the NIH have completely ignored. That is, we've got to start talking and studying about food as medicine. We may need to treat more diabetes with cooking classes than just throwing insulin at people. We need to study the environmental exposures that cause cancer, not just the chemotherapy that treats it. We've got to start getting at the underlying causes of illness if we're going to have a resilient healthcare system, because ultimately, the number one driver of the cost of a healthcare system is how healthy a population is. And we can't keep going down this road of a reactionary system. We've got to be proactive.
And if we learned anything from the last year, I mean, I'm not a doctor, but this last year has proven how important it is to be healthy and how important it is to have a solid healthcare system. I mean, how would you evaluate the way in which, you know, the American healthcare system was able to react and sort of help those people who did have COVID-19?
Look, we didn't have expandability in American hospitals because we have basically just-in-time business processes that are maximized for profit. Now, I'm not against profit, but we got to have the security in our country to be able to expand our medical capacity quickly. And it's not just for viral pandemics, antimicrobial-resistant bugs, that is, the superbugs, bacteria that are resistant to all antibiotics. They are increasing each year, and it will be guaranteed the next pandemic. It's already set in. We lost about 100,000 Americans the year prior to COVID from antimicrobial resistant organisms, that is these superbugs. It's going up every year. These are things that we can fix. We don't need just more antibiotics. We need to recognize that we got to get antibiotic overuse down both in humans and in agriculture. There are so many things we can do right now, and I don't think we're talking about the issues that we need to talk about. Hospital expandability is going to be important for future pandemics, but for hurricanes and earthquakes and mass shootings and other ways in which we need to have a resilient healthcare system, not one that simply scrambles to change their processes on a dime when something like this happens.
Just to dive a little bit deeper into your book, now, from my understanding, you traveled around the country, you know, for your book, researching and collecting different stories. Without giving any spoilers, can you tell us sort of what these stories entailed and what was your biggest takeaway?
Well, I'll tell you, the two biggest things that we can fix in healthcare are pricing failures. We need more price transparency. We need honesty with patients. When they come in asking for a price, we got to do better than we've been doing as physicians and hospitals, just giving people the runaround. We haven't had control of our billing processes as doctors. We got to take that back. Right now, we're living in an era of price gouging patients, taking advantage of them when they're vulnerable and come to the hospital. And then the hospital is engaged in predatory billing. Now, it's not everywhere, but we've got to have metrics of billing quality. So when people shop for care, they can see which hospitals do well, which hospitals are fair, which hospitals are forgiving, have good financial aid, and which hospitals will give you a price when you ask for an elective service. We've got to have a competent marketplace. The fundamental problem in healthcare is we have a non-competitive market. And when you see that, you can either say, hey, let's create a lot of regulations to create rules around the bad behavior, or you can do the fundamental change of converting it to a transparent market. That's what's happening right now. And I detail the different disruptors who have created these competitive, transparent markets in healthcare. It's not a policy book. It's a bunch of experiences, but I can tell you that one of the big misconceptions out there in America is that the government will fix healthcare, that a piece of legislation will fix healthcare, and that if there's a piece of legislation, you've got to be for it or against it, and that will be whether or not we get healthcare costs under control. Government is not going to fix healthcare, but we are going to fix it from the ground up. Doctors, nurses, hospital leaders, what we're seeing now is a rebuilding of healthcare in a way that spends time with patients, that rejects the crazy billing cycle that we're all put on, and then it starts addressing the underlying issues that bring people to care. It's a team-based approach that says maybe we should treat more back pain with ice and physical therapy instead of just surgery and opioids. This is the new mantra now. We're seeing a new generation of doctors say, let's redesign healthcare altogether and let's not wait on the government to do it. So that's what I wrote about. Pricing failures, care coordination, holistic care, and the movement to redesign healthcare by creating new clinics and new business models. And on the side, by the way, most businesses in America are getting ripped off on their healthcare benefits. They should be shopping better, and I explain how they can do that.
Well, your book sounds super interesting. The paperback, like I said, is coming out tomorrow. So I'll definitely, you know, try to grab a copy and encourage everyone, if they can, read it, just based on what you were just talking about. That sounds super interesting. Dr. Makary, thank you so much for joining me, for taking the time today. I really appreciate it. And would love to have you back on to talk about COVID-19. And, you know, as we have this conversation more and more about natural immunity, I'd always appreciate your insight about that. So thank you so much.
Great. Great to be with you, Samantha.